I started playing the flute at 11 years old. Since then, I've played in orchestras, musical pits, marching bands, drum lines, and jazz bands. Music may not have been my profession, but it is my passion, and it affects my work to this day. And that's why today I would like to talk to you about women in jazz. So before we really dive into who the women in jazz are, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about what jazz is. Jazz is considered an American form of music, which means it's influenced by cultures internationally. But it really starts to develop as a genre in the late 1800s and early 1900s. There are two genres that come before it that are going to be the main influences. That's the blues. And ragtime. Another important thing to note about jazz is that it's heavily influenced by African American music and the American political climate at the time. Jazz is really going to become popular in America in the 1920s. But at the time, there are still a lot of people singing the blues. So the first woman that we're going to talk about is actually a blues singer, Bessie Smith. She was most famous during the 20s and 30s, and she's called the Empress of the Blues. She would be the inspiration for many jazz vocalists after her, such as Billie Holiday and Ella Fitzgerald.
My man's got a heart like a rock cast in the
Lovey Austin is another blues musician who's going to help usher in this new era of jazz. She was a piano player and was considered to be one of the best ever. Mary Lou Williams would go on to cite her as one of her greatest influences and said that she was a greater talent than many of the men during this period. Before I start talking about this next musician, I want to give some context for the time period. You might notice that most of the women that I'm talking about are either vocalists or pianists. This is because at the time, it was considered unladylike for a woman to play a wind instrument. Some people say this was because they couldn't look pretty and smile while having a horn to their face. I think that's part of why I'm so fascinated with this next musician. Vallida Snow was a black woman playing a brass instrument, all things that were frowned upon, but she made a career for herself in the 20s and 30s. She could play around 10 instruments by the time she was 15 and chose to play the trumpet. She toured America and Europe, gaining fame and even being called the second best trumpet player by Louis Armstrong, second only to himself. Sadly, Vallida was captured while on tour in Denmark at the beginning of World War II, and she was held in a concentration camp by the Nazis for 18 months, weighing only 65 pounds when she left. She never fully recovered, and she would pass away from a brain hemorrhage in 56. We're entering the 1940s, jazz has gained popularity across America, and World War II starts. The men are away from home, and women are taking over jobs, and this includes entertainment. More women are hired to perform in bars and theaters than ever before. Some of the most notable women of the genre came to fame in this time period. I'm sure most of you are familiar with Ella Fitzgerald. She was a famous jazz vocalist who was born in 1917 and would gain popularity in the 30s and 40s. Fitzgerald's first big hit would be a recording of the song A Tisket a Tasket.
I lost my yellow basket. Won't someone help me find my basket and make me happy again?
Was it red?
No.
Was it green?
No.
Was it cerise?
No. Just a little yellow basket.
Fitzgerald was praised for her unique voice and her incredible ability to scat, a form of vocal improv.
the Duke and Ella. So let's have a wonderful...
Don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. Do-wah, 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 do-wah. It don't mean a thing. All you gotta do is sing. Do-wah, 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 do-wah.
Billie Holiday is another jazz vocalist, and despite having no formal training, she's very well known. One of her most famous songs is Strange Fruit. It's a song about the lynchings that were happening to Black Americans in the American South, which were at an all-time high at the turn of the century.
Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
Our last jazz vocalist is Sarah Vaughan, who had a long career into the 70s. Vaughan was noted for her distinct voice. She had a wide vocal range, and she used a lot of vibrato.
The trembling trees embrace the breeze tenderly.
Ina Ray Hutton could not play an instrument and wasn't particularly known for her singing. However, she was a band leader for the Melodeers, an all-female band that was popular during the 1930s. Hutton is more notable as a dancer than a musician, but her Melodeers would go on to inspire another very important all-female band, the International Sweethearts of Rhythm.
Everybody's talking.
They would start out as a school band in Mississippi at a school for disadvantaged children, mostly orphans, and would soon become the first integrated all-girl band in America. The International Sweethearts of Rhythm started playing professionally in the 1940s and traveled across America to perform. The band was mixed race and all female, so they weren't always well received. They would get to perform through most of the 40s, and some of the members went on to have solo careers afterwards. Bryant is one of the women from the band who had a solo career. She played the trumpet and eventually recorded her own album called Gal with a Horn. Later in life, she would be in documentaries, give lectures, mentoring students, and editing books about jazz history. The last woman from this era that I want to talk about is Peggy Gilbert, who played music for most of her life. She wanted to learn how to play a wind instrument when she was in school, but they refused to teach her, so she taught herself. She played saxophone and would lead several bands throughout her career. Peggy was very passionate about being a woman in music and played music all the way into her 80s. She passed away in 2007 at the age of 102.
And I think the most important thing in this life is that you're here for a reason. And the reason you're here is to help other people who maybe not are as fortunate as you are.
When the 50s come around, World War II is over. The men are back at home, rock and roll has risen to fame, and jazz, especially big band jazz, has fallen out of popularity. Solo artists start to become more common and new forms of jazz start to take a hold. Free jazz became popular in the 60s with composers like Carla Bley, who are constantly looking to reinvent. Free jazz is exactly what it sounds like. It doesn't abide to any of the rules that traditional jazz follows. They use different melodies and harmonies, improv has no rules, and the rhythms are much different, often slower. one thing hasn't changed. Jazz is still deeply rooted in the culture and politics of America. We can see this with Nina Simone, who was an activist and a musician who became popular in the 50s and 60s. Her song, Mississippi Goddamn, would become one of the first civil rights songs.
Alabama's got me so upset. Tennessee made me lose my rest. And everybody knows about Mississippi Goddamn.
Toshiko Akiyoshi is a jazz pianist. She was the first Japanese student at Berkeley, where she studied jazz. Jazz is considered an American music, but Akiyoshi saw an opportunity to try something new by adding a Japanese influence to her music, which set her music apart from traditional jazz. Jazz never regained the same level of popularity that it had in the early 1900s, but it never died out. People are very dedicated to keeping the music alive and teaching a new generation of musicians to play jazz. I want to talk about just a couple more women who are involved in jazz today and talk about what the legacy of jazz looks like. Terry Carrington plays the drums and teaches at Berklee College of Music. She talks about how the drums have taught her about race, age, and gender, and how it has affected her life beyond music. Regina Carter is another contemporary jazz musician. She's a violinist, which isn't a traditional jazz instrument. She plays many genres, along with her husband, who's a drummer. I think one of the most notable jazz musicians today is bassist Esperanza Spalding. She started playing music at a very young age in the 80s. Since then, she's been very successful and has even played at the White House on multiple occasions, which is where she did one of my favorite performances of the song On the Sunny Side of the Street in 2016.
Can't you hear the pit-a-pat? Every tune in your step. Life could be so sweet on the sunny side.
Without these women, I wouldn't have been able to pick up an instrument in elementary school and keep playing to this day. They worked hard as musicians, as activists, and as educators to provide a future full of music and jazz to the next generation. That's why I think we owe it to these women who came before us and the women after us to keep the music alive. If you would like to learn more about female musicians or jazz music in general, I recommend the documentaries What Happened, Miss Simone, Jazz by Ken Burns, How It Feels to Be Free, and The Girls in the Band.